Clap your hands, everybody. Come on.
Church in Little Rock, Arkansas, and we are delighted to have you with us today. Yes, I am. This morning, you are going to hear from some of our young adults who will be leading the service. They'll be doing the word. They'll be bringing the prayer, and we're excited about how God is using young adults today, how we're raising prophetic leaders to serve in the church here in Little Rock, Arkansas at Hoover Church. And so we're excited. I'm excited because God is in this place. We are excited about your sharing with us in this four-week series of Rooted. We've talked about growing, we've talked about planting, we talked about pruning, and today you're gonna hear Ruth Jones share about the harvest. So again, thank you. We're delighted to have you with us. Be sure and share, make comments, invite people to hear the word of God here at Hoover Church in our online worship experience. Thank you, and get ready to be blessed by our young people. Amen. God bless. So now this is an opportunity where you can also participate in our worship experience through the worship through giving. Did you know that we are called to tithe a tenth of every income that we receive to give it back to the Lord? We are called to give our hearts and our spirits and our souls and our services, but we're also called to give our gifts. We've been blessed that you have been providing us with your tithes and your offering, and now is an opportunity where we do this again through our worship through giving. You will see information where you can give via Giblify, as well as another way you can do it is by mailing us. You'll see the information that is below, and we thank you for giving because the Lord says, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So now is your opportunity for you to give. Remember, God loves a cheerful giver. Amen, and God bless, and thank you for your gifts.
Hello, how are y'all doing?
I'm sure many of you know who I am, but for those who don't, I'm Gabriel Tolbert, the drummer at the rest of Hoover United Methodist Memorial Church. And I'm coming to you this morning in the midst of a pandemic, bringing you a prayer from the hearts of the people and from the words of the Most High through me. If you would, at your home, you can bow or you can put your head down or you can kneel at the altar, wherever you are. And I want you to open your mind and open your heart and prepare to hear the words that have been presented through me to the Most High. Father God, right now, we come before you. We speak to the hearts and the minds of the people, Father God, that are going through things that we can't even imagine financially, spiritually, and physically, Father God. We ask that you would come into their homes, come into their hearts, come into their minds, come into their souls and heal them. Give them the things that they need, Father God. As they go out into the world, unsure the things that are going on with the virus, with violence, with so much hate around us, Father God, send your love down upon us. Father God, you deliver the children of Israel out of the wilderness and into to the breastful hope of your love that was presented in promise. And Father God, we're leaning on that promise right now, asking that you would bring it forth in the midst of all this that's going on. We're in the midst as children of Israel under the rule of Pharaoh, Father God. We look at the things that's going on and we see the government, we see all the things that are coming to life, Father God, and you're revealing them. We ask that you would continue to reveal. We also ask that you would send blessings that are coming from out of places that people don't even know where they come from, Father God. Even though people right now have deadlines and shut off notices and bad news, Father God, we know that you can turn it around in a split second and that we can look up and wonder where it came from, but in the ultimate end, we know that it was you. Father God, we know that we miss our worship places, that we come together and congregate and find peace and harmony and love within one another group and one another presence, Father God. And even through the messenger, Father God, that sends comfort, we ask that you would send those same vibes and messages through people, through video, and all across the world, even through Facebook and Instagram, wherever they may be. We might run into somebody that just sends a word to our heart to touch us and continue through the day. But Father God, however it may be, we ask that it will happen, and we claim it done right now in you and your son Jesus' mighty name. We pray, amen.
So now I have the absolute pleasure to introduce you to Ruth Ann Jones, who will be bringing the word today. I'm happy to introduce you to Ruth because Ruth has been here at Hoover most all of her life, from a babe serving from Sunday school. She's been involved here at the church. Now let me tell you about Ruth. She is a true follower of Jesus, a true committed disciple. Ruth has served as the SPRC chairperson, the chairperson, the person who is responsible for reporting to the pastor. She has served as a lay leader. She now is a co-leader in one of our small groups, which is called Radically Change. She is a youth coordinator. She has brought the message. But the most important thing about Ruth is she's a true woman of God. She has absolutely no problem serving God because she knows who she is. She is rooted, grounded, she's been pruned, and today she is harvesting the Word of God. So get ready. Welcome Ruth Ann Jones, who will be bringing us the message this morning. I'm so excited. How about you?
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Thank you. Today, my name is Ruth Jones, and I will be bringing the message today. And so today, I want to take the time to thank Pastor Bell and Reverend Robinson for allowing me to grace this platform to speak to you. I do not take it lightly. And so thank you also for giving me the opportunity to come into your home to speak as well. Let us go to God in prayer. God, I thank you for your mercy and your grace at this time. I pray that you would guide my words on this day. Help me to walk in obedience in delivering your word that you have given to me today. Your word heals. And so I pray that in this word that you have given to me, that it will bring not only insight, but healing and deliverance to us, your people, and our households. I pray that you protect us, that you would protect me, my family, and my household as I give this word today to your people, and that no harm will come to me or to them. It is in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Well, today, I believe I have a word. Today, the scripture will be coming from Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 through 10. And I am using the New King James Version in this regard to this scripture. And it reads, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season, if we do not lose heart, we shall reap. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Proverbs 18:21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. We play so much with our lives in this way. We take words and we throw them out. We are prone to just say anything. We take what someone says and meditate on it instead of meditating on the Word of God. Our words are powerful, yet we forget how powerful they are. The root of the fruit always comes back to what we are speaking out of our mouths. What am I saying about myself? What am I saying about my family and friends? What am I saying? Am I hurting or helping? Our pastor, Deborah Bell, spoke about the root in the beginning of the series and how you have to dig deep to plant. When you continue to hear something over and over and over again, you're planting words. It goes into the deep souls of your heart, coupled with the action that it may be good or bad. Are you planting words of wisdom? What are you planting? Our heart is so fragile, yet so strong. If we look at the physical heart, the heart has valves. The valves make sure that the flow of the blood flows through one direction. One direction. However, if the blood flows, goes into another direction, there becomes a problem, and you can feel it. It may be minor, it may be major, but it causes you to stop what you are doing and reevaluate. Words are that powerful. We tolerate people calling us out of our names. We think it's funny. We laugh, we joke around. This is what we have tolerated in our lives, not recognizing the flow that is causing to take place in our lives. If we are meditating on the Word of God and receiving the good that someone says, that's positive flow. But if we are constantly taking in the negative with the positive, those are two different directions, opposite directions. Confusion steps in when that happens. Just like the flow of the heart, there becomes a problem. And sometimes, like what we may experience with our physical heart, like lightheadedness, we don't think nothing about it. We just go and lay down. But when it gets to the point of being unable to breathe, we recognize the problem. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. If you were honest with yourself and took the time to look at your life, what do you see? Do you see life or do you see death? There are areas in our lives that may have life in them, but there are also areas in our lives that we may see death in them. However, just because you see death in them, God may see life. Isaiah 55 verse 8 says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways nor your ways. Just because the heart may be damaged doesn't mean it can't be fixed. The cardiologist fixes our physical heart, but God fixes our spiritual heart. However, there are steps that we have to take as well. The cardiologist gives us steps to keep our hearts in shape, and God gives us steps as well. Proverbs 23:7 says, so a man thinketh that he is. Another version says, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Who are you? How do you see yourself? What word has been planted that causes you to continue to go down the path that you are on? What has caused you not to believe in yourself? And what God can do in your life? What makes you think that it is over for you and that nothing can change? What thoughts have you planted inside of your mind that continues to play over and over again? Sometimes we think that we are going along the right way in the right direction and that just may not be the case. Isaiah 55, I'm saying it again, and I'm at verse 9. It says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts. And so my ways My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Pruning was talked about last week. And if we are honest with ourselves, no one wants anything taken off. Pruning involves cutting. Pruning doesn't just involve cutting off the old. It involves cutting off what may be good to you. The key word is you. What may be good to you? It's good to you, but it's not good for you. God may have more things for you to do, or He may want to give you something else. He has to cut off some things that you may like or may even love, and it may hurt worse than cutting off what may be considered what is negative in your life. If God is saying, I have come to give you an abundant life, not just life, but abundant life, let me read it for your remembrance. In John 10:10, Jesus is telling a story, and He is using an allegory to share the story of the Good Shepherd, and then to break it all the way down to the disciples. He explains it again by telling them and us what is He trying to give us. And it reads, The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. And I have come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly. And if you consider yourself one of His disciples, He's talking to you too. For a disciple is a follower. Don't get it twisted. You're following someone. Who is it? I don't know, but I digress. Let me get back to my point. The point I'm trying to make is, if you want to move forward in life, everything can't stay the same. God wants you to have an abundant life, and that requires all of us to let go of the good and the bad and allow the pruning, the cutting away, to happen. It looks different for all of us. And sometimes it can just be plain devastating because we got used to something being a part of our lives. Jesus says, I have come not only to bring life, but that you may have it abundantly. A lot of life, a lot of joy, a lot of love. I started thinking about the word life, and so I decided to look it up. Life means the condition that distinguishes animals and plants from inorganic matter, including the capacity for growth, reproduction, functional activity, and continual change preceding death. The existence of an individual human being or animal, a particular type of aspect. Life. The existence of an individual human being or animal in a particular type of aspect. Life. God wants to give you the capacity for continued growth, more reproduction, more continual change. Bring more to your existence. He wants to bring more to the condition of your existence. He wants to bring you more energy. He wants to give you more vitality. And only He knows what that looks like for you. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. Fruit comes from the root. You may be rooted in God, but your words don't show that. Therefore, you are harvesting the fruit. Your actions don't show that. Therefore, you are harvesting the fruit. How much are you rooted? Did you uproot yourself? If you did, it's time to get back to the roots. It's time to study the character of God. It's time to study the character of Jesus. What am I rooted in? When you are truly rooted in God, the fruit will show. When you are living the Word of God, the fruit will show. When you are walking in the Word and studying the Word, the fruit will show. What does that fruit look like? It looks like love. It looks like joy. It looks like peace, kindness. Paul shares with us in Galatians 5 that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. These are the components that make up the fruit that should be evident in our lives. These are the components that helps us to have the abundant life that Jesus offers to us. What can stifle the fruit or choke the fruit? Our words. What can help produce the fruit? Our words. What did we hear growing up? Practice makes perfect. And I hope that you don't have a negative connotation with those words. Because just like we exercise our bodies to be a certain way, we have to put in the same type of regimen with our spiritual lives. We have to create a course, a way of life, and be disciplined enough to follow it in our daily spiritual life. We have to practice walking in order to see the fruit. We have to study to show, we have to study to know how to practice. We don't have to do everything at once. That's not what I'm saying. How do I show love? What is love? If love is patient and kind, how do I practice that for this fruit to be a part of my life? We have to mirror the attributes of Jesus. But if I don't know the attributes of Jesus, I can't practice it. If I don't know that the power that Jesus operated in is the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, then it's hard for me to practice because I don't know where to begin. The Bible says to study to show yourself approved. We study sports, we study designs, we study a lot of things. So the problem is not studying, but what are we studying? Are we studying the Word of God to show ourselves approved? If I am studying the Word of God and not just reading or listening, because today technology helps us, then I will be able to start practicing the Word and will be able to produce the fruit because I will be able to hear God's voice when I am about to make the wrong decision or just trying to make a decision, and I will be able to work with another individual because God has given me insight on how I need to respond. And then I will be able to reap the harvest. And that harvest may be peace. That harvest may be love. Because you took the time to plant the seed of peace and of love. Therefore, you reaped peace and love. I keep saying life and death are in the power of the tongue because we are made in God's image. Do you recognize that? God created me and you. In Genesis 1:26, he says, "Let us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, make man in our image according to our likeness." In Genesis, God is speaking life everywhere. The Holy Spirit is moving. He says, "Let there be light," and there was light. He kept speaking the creation into existence. And my point is, if we are created in his image, in his likeness, we have this power too. This is the way that we are like our Creator. But we don't recognize the power of our words. Or have we forgotten the power? Maybe that's it. I don't know. Ma'am, sir, look at your life and ask yourself, am I acting like the one who created me? When he gave me the opportunity to rule over the earth, do I know how to use this authority, this power, to rule correctly? Okay, let me say it another way. God spoke and created. When I speak, I create. What harvest you are producing depends on what words you are saying and what you are allowing to even be said over you. Again, we play too much. We do not consider or take into account the words that we speak over ourselves and the ones we love or care about. We assume it is all about us individually, but it is not. It is about us collectively. We are one body. You are part of a body. Whether you are the foot, the ear, the mouth, you are part of a body. Your words matter. Your words matter. God loves us so much that he forgives us and doesn't remember our sin and that they are cast into the sea of forgiveness. We are reminded of this in Micah 7, verse 19. God says, "Cast your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you." He cares for you. You do not have to keep worrying. Worrying causes sickness. Give it to God. He can carry it better. He's a burden bearer and a heart fixer. God loves us so much that he gave up his son to die on the cross for me and you. He tells us, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things will be added to you. You can build some roots right here. Consider your ways. If you have used your words to speak negative over your life and others, repent. Just repent. And repent means to turn away. Turn away. Make a decision to walk in the fruit of the Spirit. This is not something you have to do by yourself, because Jesus left us a comforter, the Holy Spirit. In John 14, 16, he says he will pray and ask the Father for a helper for us to be with us forever. He sent us a comforter and a helper to teach us all things. And he is here to help you and I walk in the things of God so that you can have life and so we can experience life abundantly. He teaches us how to love ourselves and how to love others correctly. He is a healer. He is a helper. God desires a relationship with us. He is the one that corrects all the other relationships and even gives us brand new relationships that can assist us on this new journey of life. You are a new creature in Christ. You are a new creature in Christ. Now, unfortunately, because of some things that we've done, there will be some people who won't forgive us for the wrong that we have done and the mistakes that we have made towards them. But we need to pray for them. That is what we're to do, to pray for them. But don't get it twisted. Don't get it mistaken. God forgives us anyway. God can help you forgive yourself and work on everybody else's heart that you love. We serve a no-limit God. There are no limits to what God can do. He can fill that void that is empty in your heart, but you have to give it to him. He may know all about it, but the steps we have to take is to give it to him. Just like in a relationship with others, unless you give them permission, they can't help you like he or she may want. I am a testament that he has filled many voids in my life and continues to rock me in his arms daily. Harden not your heart. Open it up and try him. There will always be seed time and harvest time. We will always be sowing and reaping. But the question is, what are you sowing and what are you reaping? What results are you producing?
Well, we have heard a mighty word. We have been blessed with scriptures that will help us to reap the harvest for Jesus. So this morning, this is the invitation. We are inviting you. If you have felt like, you know, I don't know what I can harvest. I'm ready to produce, but I'm not sure if I've been grounded or rooted enough. I need to be pruned. God has pruned me, but yet I'm still not showing in harvest. Today, we'd like to invite you to come and be a member here at the Rest of Hoover Memorial United Methodist Church. We're a church with truly open doors and open minds, serving the community, working beyond the walls for many years. This is a place where you just don't come and be a participant. You come and worship and disciple to the community. So we want to invite you. We'd love to have you. If you feel that you need prayer and that God is calling you to serve, all you have to do, you'll see information listed below. Just give us a call, send us an email. We're ready to disciple you. We're ready to help you to reap the harvest which God has planted for you. So this morning, again, thank you for joining us. It's always a delight to have you. And I'm excited because I had a chance today to be preached to be prayed to this morning in this worship service. Again, we look forward to seeing you on next week. We have now ended our Rooted series where, again, we have been growing and planting and pruning and harvesting, ready to make disciples for the transformation of the world. So again, thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you next week. God bless and amen.